Welcome to Family Life Connected. I'm Pastor Ray, and this is Pastor Esther. We're so glad you're with us today.
We sure are, because you are going to grow a little closer to Jesus. You know, we've been saying this is our year of renewal.
That's
what does
right.
that mean? New things. And I feel like, you know, there's a time where people are looking to God, asking Him for help, asking Him for healing, asking Him for wisdom, asking Him for, you know, what to do, even about the vaccination, you know, all those kind of things. There are so many unknowns in the world, but you know what God says in Psalms 143, verse 10 says, "Teach me to do your will." This was David's prayer.
Nice.
"For you are my God. May your gracious spirit lead me forward on a firm footing." When we don't know what to do, when we're not sure about things, God is our firm foundation.
Amen.
He will help us and He will guide us. He will lead us. He will teach us to do His will. Why? Because He's our God and we are His people. That's what the Bible says about us. And so we are so incredibly blessed to be in a place that
That's
we
for sure.
know our God, and that we know that He's for us, and that we know He's on our side, and that we know we can count on Him, and that we know that He will give us wisdom, that He will lead us, that He will guide us. So let's pray right now. Father God, we just thank You that if there are any unknowns going on right now in a person's life that's listening to this right now, we thank You. You will lead us and guide us. We thank You that You will give us ideas. You will give us insight. You will give us understanding. And we thank You, Lord God, that we can always count on You, that You will always lead us towards peace. So we thank You for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So thankful for You. We sure love You guys.
Welcome to Family Life Connected. I'm Pastor Ray Almiger, and I'm so glad you're with us today. I believe God's dropped something into my heart to really help us all today. We talked last Sunday on Easter Sunday about trusting a risen Savior. So I got to thinking, okay, now that I've trusted Him, what does that mean for my life? Well, what does that mean to me? And you know what that means? It means we get to live a new life now. Here's what I know. God created you and me to know Him. He wants an intimate, deep, personal relationship with us. If you go back and read the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis, Adam enjoyed this. Adam and his wife Eve enjoyed this close, personal, intimate relationship, a growing relationship with God. The Bible says they walked with God in the garden in the cool of the day. And even when Adam messed up and his sin messed all of this up, what God intended for you and me, Adam's sin messed it all up. But even when that happened, God went looking for him. God went to restore him. God sought to bring reconciliation to him. God wants us to live a new life now. And even though Adam messed all of that up with sin way back in the garden, Jesus, whom the Bible calls the last Adam or the second Adam, Jesus came to fix it all up and to restore it all back to us again. We get to live a new life now. And so now, right now, now, because of what Jesus has done, I have a new relationship with God. Right now, I have it now. Not going to get to heaven one day. Now, when I receive Jesus Christ into my heart as Lord and Savior, I have a new relationship with God. And this is all taught in the book of Romans, chapter number 5. The Bible says this, and we're talking about Jesus restored our relationship with God. Romans chapter 5, verse 1 to about 11. Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand. And we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. We can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, for we know they help us develop endurance. And endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead to disappointment, for we know how dearly God loves us, because He has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with His love. When we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. Now, most people would not be willing to die for an upright person, though someone might perhaps be willing to die for a person who is especially good. But God showed His great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. And since we've been made right in God's sight by the blood of Christ, He will certainly save us from God's condemnation. For since our friendship with God was restored by the death of His Son while we were still His enemies, we will certainly be saved through the life of His Son. So now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God because our Lord Jesus Christ has made us friends of God. Wow! Isn't that amazing? Isn't that beautiful? I would encourage you to go on to read the entirety of chapter number 5 and see everything here that God has done for you and me in restoring our relationship with God. You and I, right now, I now have a new relationship with God. And I have been made right in God's sight by the blood of Jesus. Let me say it again. This is so important. I have been made right in God's sight. The Bible just said that. I have been made right. You and I have been made right in God's sight by the blood of Jesus. We are made right in God's sight. Listen, when we believe in Jesus, when we call upon Him as Lord and Savior, when we believe in Him, then everything He did in His death and resurrection is applied to our life. And we are made right with God. We are made right in God's sight by the blood of Jesus. When we put our faith in what Jesus has done for us, listen, we are placed in right standing with God. And this is important. What I'm going to say next, please get this. This right standing with God is called righteousness. Righteousness means to be right with God. Righteousness means right standing with God. Righteousness is a gift God gives to us. The moment we say yes to Jesus, the moment we accept Him into our heart and accept His sacrifice on the cross and believe that God raised Him from the dead, believe He died and rose again, that moment, everything that Jesus came to do is applied to you and me. We're washed in His blood. We're born again. And we're given the gift of right standing with God. Isn't that amazing? See, I run into Christians all the time. They think that they've got to work for this, that the more they do, the more good they do, the more good deeds they do, the better life they live, that they somehow gain God's favor that way, that somehow God loves them more. We had a person come to church some years ago, and somehow she got all hung up. I don't know where she had been taught this before, but she kept thinking, well, you know, the more I serve and the more I do, the more God will love me. Listen, friends, that is really faulty thinking. God loves you unconditionally. And the fact is, if you think that way, you're going to burn yourself out because you can never do enough. You can never serve enough. You can never give enough. You can never sacrifice enough. You can never obey enough to where you feel that somehow you're now right in God's sight, because that's not the way it works. It's a gift. We're made right in God's sight by the blood of Jesus. And the Bible calls this the gift of righteousness. Righteousness means right standing with God. Righteousness is a gift that God gives us. It is not some wage that we earn through hard work and years of striving and years of struggling, trying to get better and to be a better Christian. Now listen, we all want to grow in Christ. We all want to live a life of obedience. But as far as God is concerned and the blood of Jesus is concerned, we are forgiven from day one. We are made right with God from day one. So we should work out our salvation, but we don't work for our salvation. Did you get that? The Bible says to work out our salvation, but we never have to work for it. We receive salvation by faith, and we receive the gift of righteousness by faith. It is credited to our account, if you want to say it that way, by faith in a risen Savior. What great news that is. It's a gift given to us the moment we believe in Jesus. It's a gift given by God. Again, not a wage that we finally earn. And it's not about what I have done. I can never do enough. It's not about what I have done. It is about what the Lord Jesus has done. And friends, He has done enough. He became our sin upon the cross. The Bible says, Him who knew no sin was made to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. We're declared to be in right standing with God. It's a new relationship, all because of what Jesus has done for you and me. Let me say, this is so important. We are made right with God by faith in Jesus Christ. I have a new relationship with Him. Also, secondly, I now stand in a place of undeserved privilege. We don't deserve this, but God gives it to us anyway. We don't deserve this, but God says, here you go. We don't deserve this, but God loves us so much, He gives it to us anyway. And we stand because of what Jesus has done. We now stand in, by faith in Christ, we now stand in this place of undeserved privilege. And this undeserved privilege is called grace. By faith, we enter into grace. By faith, we have access. We access the grace of God. Listen, by faith, we access the unlimited grace of God, the unlimited riches of His glory, the unlimited mercies which endure forever. We access it all by faith. Many years ago, I used to just help out in church. You know, I had a key for this door, or maybe for that door. But then one day I became the pastor. And guess what? I had the master key. I had access to every door. And when we have faith in our heart in the Lord Jesus Christ, we have access to all the grace we will ever need. But we have to access it by faith. How is that done? We lay hold of a promise of God. We see it in the Word. We believe it. We claim it by faith. We say, by faith, I believe I receive that faith. Gives us access to the unlimited riches of God's grace. Glory to God. This undeserved privilege, let me say it again, is called the grace of God. Grace is this. Here's a way you can maybe remember it. Just remember G-R-A-C-E, grace. God's riches at Christ's expense. That's what grace is right there. He paid the price. We receive the benefits of it. Grace is God's unmerited favor. Grace is receiving what we don't deserve and not receiving what we do deserve. Grace is God's willingness to help us. It's more than, that's where it goes more than favor. Because God could say, you know what, if you could figure out a way to get saved, I'd be in favor of that, but I'm not going to help you. Well, what good would that do for us? What God did is he sent his only begotten son. So grace is God's favor in action toward you and me. Grace is God's favor and his willingness to help us. You know, the Bible says God works in us to will and to do of his good pleasure. That means that he puts in us a desire and the ability to do what he's asked us to do. Wow. So whatever it is God has put in your heart, he has given you the gifts, the abilities, the power to do exactly what it is he's asked you to do. What a deal. Don't you wish people knew this? The average person, that's why you and I have got to be salt and light to a lost world. The average person thinks God's mad at them. They don't know that God's already washed away their sins in Christ. The average person thinks God's against them. They don't know that God's already placed us in right standing with himself by faith in a risen Savior. They need to know. They need to know God's riches at Christ's expense. That's our job, to be salt and light to a lost and to a dying world. Jesus took the punishment for our sins. Why? Because he loves us. I think I was just reading how in law enforcement and in courts of law, oftentimes a person, because they love for a loved one, they'll take the rap. They'll say, no, that was my gun, or those were my drugs. And if the person they love especially has already been in trouble before and they don't want to see him get in more trouble, oftentimes they'll step up and say, that was mine. And the thing is, oftentimes the defense lawyers and the prosecutors, they know this, but there's nothing they can do because that person is stepping up, taking the rap for their loved one. Hey, Jesus did that for you and me while we were still his enemies. The Bible says while we were sinners, Christ died for us. That's how much he loves us. He took the rap for us. He paid the price for us. He became our scapegoat. In fact, you know the word scapegoat is actually a Bible word. We find it in the Old Testament referring to the sacrificial animal that the high priest used to offer up in the Old Testament days, of which that was a type and a shadow of Christ when he was to come. That's why he's called the Lamb of God. Get this, in the book of Revelation, of all the titles that Jesus has ascribed, he's called King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Good Shepherd, Great Shepherd, Son of God, Bright and Morning Star, all the great things he's called in the Word of God. Some 28 times in the book of Revelation, he is called the Lamb of God. And that may be because when we get to heaven, of all the names and all the titles and all the things we are thankful for, it will be that he died for our sins that tops the list. Because without that, we wouldn't even be there with him. He is our sacrificial lamb. He paid the price for you and me. And I will be eternally grateful for God's amazing grace. What else am I now in this new life I have now? I am now a friend of God. We just read that in Romans chapter 5. We are now friends of God. You know the word friend means this, one attached to another by affection or esteem, one that is not hostile. God's not hostile to us. We've been made friends of God by the blood of Jesus. In fact, the Bible calls that reconciliation. when maybe there was a separation between two, and then something happened to bring reconciliation. We use this term oftentimes. Maybe a married couple is having difficulties, or maybe they've had a separation, and they get things worked out. Maybe they get counsel, and somebody else intervenes, and they have reconciliation. Well, listen, between us and God, there was a wide chasm that we could never bridge, and Jesus came. And he died on the cross for you and me, and he brought reconciliation, no hostility, friendship with God. The Bible calls us friends of God right now. Did you know you're a friend of God? Did you know the Bible calls you, if you believe in Jesus, you're God's friend? You might say, I never heard such a thing. Well, the book of Romans tells us that. Maybe you hadn't heard that before. I mean, I grew up my whole life, I never heard that. But when I found out God is my friend, it changed my life forever. God loves us so much, he gave his one and only son to die for us to restore our friendship with him. And because of the blood of Jesus, there is no more hostility between us and God. Forgiveness, righteousness, atonement, remission of sins, it's all been done by the blood of Jesus. Now, think about friendship. What do friends do for one another? Number one, friends stand by one another. And the Bible says, I will never fail you. I will never abandon you. I am a friend of God. God is my friend. What else do friends do for one another? Friends support one another. The Bible says, I will hold you up with my victorious right hand. God promised that. Why? Because you and I are friends with God. God counts us as his friend. What do friends do for one another? Friends share with one another. I've got a friend like that. My very best friend is my wife, Esther. We can share anything. And she's my closest friend. And we've been married for 40 years. I have a great pastor friend, my friend, Pastor Rob Spina. We can talk about anything. We can share anything. And we do these things. We support each other. We strengthen each other. We're there for each other. Listen, but more than that, my closest friend of all is God. God is my friend. The Lord Jesus is my friend. Friends share with one another. God invites us to pour out our heart before him. You can share anything with him. What do friends do for one another? Friends stick with one another. The Bible says he is an ever-present help in trouble. I remember one time I got in trouble and friends who were with me could have maybe helped me. They took off running as fast as they could. I ended up getting in trouble and ended up being a bad situation. I thought, what kind of friends are that? They were friends if things were going good. As soon as something went bad, bam, they hit the road, Jack, and they did not come back no more. You know what I mean? And so that's not what God does. He's an ever-present help in trouble. And what do friends do for one another? Friends strengthen one another. And God promised, I will strengthen you and help you. See, we're friends. We're friends with God. So I encourage you, let God be your closest friend. He will never let you down. He will never abandon you. He will never betray you. He will never stab you in the back. He will never fail you. Let God be your closest friend. And because I have a new relationship with God, and I have a new standing with God, and because I'm a friend of God, I now have a new outlook on life. Because these things are true, because of a new relationship with God, because of a new standing with God, because I'm a friend of God, it changes the way I look at my life. I rejoice, and we saw it there in Romans chapter 5. I can actually rejoice when I run into problems. Say what? Most people I know get mad. Not so wrong. You forgot God was on your side. You forgot you had the promises of God. You forgot that God was with you at all times. Listen, we can rejoice. We can have a whole new look at this. In fact, the book of James tells us to let it be an opportunity for great joy when you run into problems. Very similar to what Romans chapter 5 tells us. So I rejoice when I run into problems. Why? It was in the word right there. I develop endurance. I develop strength of character. I develop confident expectation of deliverance. I'm going to get through this problem. I'm going to find an answer. And four, I know how dearly God loves me. Those four things right there. When I understand those four things right there, I don't worry when problems come. I understand they're part of life. I'm not afraid when problems come. I understand God is on my side. I'm not saying, why did God let me down when problems come? Because problems come to everybody. This isn't heaven, this is earth. And if there's only one place you can be on planet earth where you have no more problems, and that's a cemetery, and I'm not ready for that yet. And so other than that, listen, when we think of the phrase, run into problems. That means you're moving. You're going forward, and the more you go, the more you're going to encounter. That is okay, because God is on our side. I have a new outlook on life because of what Jesus has done for me. I have a new relationship. I am his friend, and I am his child. I have a new standing. I now stand in a place of undeserved privilege and grace. I have a new outlook. I have hope in any situation, because he loves me. Friends, this is how we live a new life now. I pray you'll take this. I pray you'll run with this. I pray you will live like it is true, because it is. Would you pray with me right now? If you've never asked Jesus to come into your heart, just join me now in this wonderful prayer. Lord Jesus, I believe you died for me and you rose again from the dead. Come into my heart. Come into my life. I make you my Lord and Savior. In your name I pray, amen. If you prayed that simple prayer, congratulations, you've been born again. If you don't have a home church and you're in our area, come to us here. Come visit us at Family Life Church. You will be right at home. You'll be part of the family. If you're viewing us from out of the area, I pray you find a good home church in your area where the Word of God is taught. Let me pray for you right now. Father, I pray for all my friends right now that we will make up our minds to live a new life in Christ and put all these truths to work. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Friends, remember to like us and follow us and be a blessing and share this with a friend. Go to our webpage at flchurch.tv. Send your prayer requests in. You can give there. God bless you. God is on our side. We'll see you next time.
Hi, Family Life Church. I'm Peggy Cortez, and I'm the director of the Children's Ministry. As many of you know, we have returned to service, and we're having a great time in the Children's Ministry, and we're hoping that you parents will be bringing your kids by really soon. We are open, we're having fun, and we're using all the safety protocols. So we hope to see you soon. And if we don't see you, please remember that we have Life Kids lessons posted online at Family Life Church. Thank you so much, and have a great day.
Hi, I'm Issa, the tech coordinator here at Family Life. I just want to say thank you for joining us today. If you enjoyed our message, click on our like button and share with your friends. If you want to stay up to date with our messages, go ahead and click that subscribe button.
Our winter life groups have officially begun. Life groups are a great way for you to get connected with other believers and grow a little closer to Jesus. If you would like to sign up for one, you can go ahead and click on the link in the description. 2020 giving summaries are now available. If you would like to request yours, you can do so by going to our website.
Your needs matter to God, and we would love to pray for you. So if you have any prayer requests, go ahead and visit our website. The link is in the description. If you would like to give today, there are three ways to give. You can give online at our website, or you can give through mail. We also have text to give. Thanks for joining us, and we hope you have a blessed week.